Alright, welcome back to more Neo 2, no damage at level 1. The boss fights of the second DLC this time, so let's start with Yorimitsu.
Tōmagashira Yorimitsu, Kenzan. Kyō o sawagasu oni domo de, otonashiku tamashiro o yokose!
She can start off with several yokai summons, but instead of burst countering, I run around to attack her directly. And then I side stray for ground AoEs, and when she has the 7 brand sword out, she has extreme hyper armor, so I only counter after a spinning jump attack or an overhead attack. Those are the only true safe opportunities that you will get. However, when she switches to a regular sword, you can counter attack basically after any attack she does. A lot of them you can essentially regard as AoE attacks, so it is a matter of spacing. Stay just outside of her reach and counter attack as soon as her attack is over. And the great thing about using Tantras in this fight is that you can do massive ki damage when she blocks your attack. Especially after she does a grab, because then she won't recover any ki. And if you manage to break her ki, you can finish the fight before she can go out of the Dark Realm. Because when she does, the fight becomes a clusterfuck. Because with the Guardian Spirits out, she has both extreme hyper armor and leaves almost no time for counterattacks to begin with. So it's pretty helpful to avoid that phase altogether. And the fight against her automatically ends when she has about 30% health left. Which is good because I almost got way too greedy near the end. Alright, Tsugigumo, the Sparta boss. Now, the weird thing is that in the successful attempt, I made all kinds of mistakes, yet I didn't actually get hit. So ironically, most unsuccessful attempts were technically better fights, until getting hit of course. But what I mean by that is that at several moments in the fight, I attacked when it wasn't actually safe to attack. So I will point those moments out on screen. But my basic strategy in this fight is to constantly move away from him and block his jump attacks, and then counter with a strong attack to break the Amrita on his back for massive damage, or counter with a weak attack when it's already broken to preserve ki. He will regenerate the Amrita after a while. The problem though is that there seems to be a little logic to when the game counts your attack as hitting the Amrita and when not. So that kinda sucks. At least I can say that strong attacks from the katana are the most consistent way to break it. This fight is all about ki management, because unless you are at full ki or nearly at full ki, you cannot safely block his jump attack. Now you can actually simply outrun it or dodge it, although it does leave a shockwave, so the hitbox is larger than you would think. However, then you cannot safely counterattack anymore. So that should only be done if your ki meter is too low. However, when he jumps from the wall, never do a strong attack, always do a weak attack. And the main reason for this blocking strategy is his giant combo. While technically he has two variations, but they are equally as dangerous. So that's what you need to stay away from. It's a giant moving hitbox. He periodically does burst attacks and makes sure to counter those, but never follow up with an attack, because he might immediately do his giant combo afterwards, and then you won't be able to get away from him if he does. So the point is, you cannot predict that. But if you manage to drain his ki with a burst counter, you automatically get a knockdown where you can use your dagger for massive damage. He also has a grab attack, and you can avoid it and then counterattack, but that's only really safe to do when you are at full ki. After all, you lose almost all of your ki when you block without armor, so when you then also attack, you only have a little bit left to run away from him. And that means that you need every opportunity you get to let your ki recover. And that's also why burst countering is so important, because that automatically refills your ki if you have that perk unlocked in your yokai skill tree. For some reason, White Tiger is back, which is kind of lazy, but whatever. However, although he is similar to his Neo 1 counterpart, they did change it up a bit. And as a result, I fight him quite differently, as I stay at mid-distance a lot. I'm also using the new claw weapon that was introduced in this DLC. You can get some free hits in at the start and use spacing rather than dodging against his spin attack. Immediately attack after the third tail stab when he attacks with his tails, and when he does the laser, get to his side. And the hitbox is actually quite generous in your favor, because it kinda looks like you get hit, but you don't. I switched to a Phantom Spear because I had trouble countering his erratic spinning burst attack. After a somersault, simply expect that he will do a dash attack as a follow-up, just to be safe. Now, before he goes into the Dark Realm, you can counterattack after a dash, but after the first phase, that is no longer truly safe. He has several variations of his laser attack, all but one can be avoided by running to his side. Only one wide sweeping version needs to be dodged through, which happened when he was in the Dark Realm phase. When he goes into the Dark Realm, I get really cautious because now he recovers extremely quickly after each attack. In fact, even when he does a laser attack and you get immediately to his side, he might still dodge away before you can even attack. Also, he really tends to spam the dash attack, and from now on he can do a double dash as well. The dash attack can be avoided by simply running sideways. And when he goes out of the Dark Realm, his moveset remains the same, so he doesn't go back to how he was before, meaning that you cannot get greedy with your attacks. Preferably do single attacks only. And one last thing, when he attacks with his paws, in the first phase you can safely attack after the third strike. However, you do have to be ready to immediately dodge another paw strike if necessary. However, when he is in the Dark Realm or after that, he can do that fourth strike immediately after the third. So I would simply not counterattack after his paw strikes to begin with from then on.
ようやく思い出せたわい。 急いでドーマンを止めねば。これ以上市中に音量が増えてはまずい。どの世の災いを起こすか予測できんと。私の映し見に様子を探らせておきましょう。この穴の奥はさらに鬼が増えよう。
Okay, Doman is a really boring fight, and he also has very little health, contrary to the Lightning God after this, who has way too much health. Really, all this fight comes down to is side strafing to avoid his projectiles. And then launching yourself forward with the strong attack of the Switchglaive. Now he will quite often dodge your attack, but it's only a matter of time before he goes down if you keep this up. In fact, this was my second attempt, and I can't say I really knew what I was doing. This just seemed like an obvious strategy, and clearly it worked. Oh, and when he summons those paper figures, make sure that you don't get close to them, because they will explode like proximity mines. Fortunately, even though Doman sort of served as the first phase to the Lightning God fight, you only have to beat him once. Now, as I said, the Lightning Gods have way too much health. I actually maximized my damage output, but by no means did I feel overpowered, even though you would think I would be. Now, this fight is all about AoE attacks, so running and spacing is everything. When she teleports towards you, she leaves a trail of lightning behind her, and it's not safe to counterattack her to begin with, because you first need to see what she follows up with. You can outrun the vertical waves, but if you see that you won't make it, use the Feral Burst counter to cover extra distance. She can also summon two variations of orbs that turn into homing projectiles, and you need to sidestrafe to avoid those, and be far away. It won't work when you are too close. When you hit the Amrita on her body, or skulls or whatever, she staggers so you can get an extra attack in, if you have sufficient ki remaining. When she attacks with her claws, only counterattack if it's a 4-hit combo. She also has a sort of regular AoE attack as well, and that's literally a matter of spacing and staying just outside of it. However, when she summons the lightning clouds, the arena becomes very small. So I simply start running around the edge until they dissipate. And that way I can also automatically avoid the homing projectiles when she summons the orbs. Again, there are two variants, but this strategy works against both variations. Now, if you get the opportunity, then make sure to do a ki pulse in those blue yokai pools to get an extra damage boost, because as I said, she has a very large health pool, and my damage output in this fight is already very, very high. So patience is also very important in this fight. As far as I can tell, the fight is the same when she goes out of the Dark Realm. The only difference is that she no longer has Amarita on her body, meaning that she can no longer stagger. Other than that, I at least didn't notice any difference. Maybe she can do something new, but then it means I simply haven't seen her do it. At the end, I thought I killed her already, but she had a little smidgen of life left. And then she went back into the Dark Realm and summoned the Lightning Clouds. So I was like, fuck it, and I simply finished her off with my bow. Lol. And that's it. Those were all the main mission boss fights of the second Nioh 2 DLC. If you haven't checked out my previous Nioh 2 level 1 no damage fights, feel free to check them out. And I also did a similar sort of run for Nioh 1. Subscribe if you like what you saw, and perhaps I will see you back when the third and final DLC comes out. Thanks for watching.